researching mudflood for several years now, and I constantly get asked the question, how did the mudflood occur? And I have thought about this question for a long time, and I have researched and looked at film and video and pictures and read and conversated with people for years, and I've come up with a few ideas of how I think that happened to an extent. But recently I had an epiphany of sorts, a new idea, let's call it, of how the mud flood could have happened. And so I went and ran it by some of my comrades in the mudflood community in my mudflood club on MeWe, and that would be Caleb Wilkinson and Ozbeast, and you've probably heard of one or both of them. And I ran it past those guys to see what they thought of it, to test, you know, if the idea held water. And in the process of that, we came up with some additional thoughts to the idea. And I would like to share that with the community tonight, and give you an idea of how I got here and what this new theory is. So one night I was doing some research for a new video, and I was looking at Google Earth, as one does in some researching events, and I ended up in Sacramento. And Sacramento has a area called Old Sacramento, and that is the area that is right here. See, it says Old Sacramento there. And all Old Sacramento is right here. Now, this is not the original Old Sacramento. Originally, it was much larger, but it got reduced because they wanted to redo the entire city. And the citizens hooted and hollered until they saved this one area. And they even wanted to run this road here, I-5, right through it. And if you'll notice, if I back up, I-5 runs straight and then straight up here. And they curved it around Old Sacramento here. So they saved Old Sacramento. Now, if you know anything about mudflood research, you know that Old Sacramento is flooded as a son of a bitch. Okay. The story goes that they raised the city of Sacramento, the old Sacramento area, back in old time, back in the 1900s, they raised the entire city. And if you do this research long enough, you'll realize that that's a horseshit narrative, and that's not true. So anyways, let me go ahead and get down in here, and I just want to do some running around in here and see. I want to walk around in here, and I was doing this the night that I had my little epiphany. I was just taking a tour of Old Sacramento, and I was just looking around to see what was left, because this is a tourist trap now. You see some mud flood drop in right here. Right here, got some mudflood windows. All of this, it is known, the official story is that they raised this entire area, okay? And that they raised a lot more than this, but they eventually tore that down and rebuilt the city. So it's known that this area is raised, okay? Check that out underground. But the truth is that this area was flooded, and they had to raise it because it was under the mud. And look at that nice window underground there, nice arched window. See if we can look back the other way. another arch wind underground that's been bricked up. But they have turned this into a tourist attraction, and you know, that's cool, but it's all a whole shit narrative. This place was flooded out during the mud flood, and let's see, they have really snowed the people over because, you know, they saved this part. Look at all that underground right there. And they, this is the railroad museum right here, which is kind of cool. Look at those arches. Yeah, this is above ground. Imagine what's underground. They have tours of this, and I have a video of the tours of this place in my mud pavement light videos and in the underground section. Oh, this is cool. Let's go back and make sure we see this. Got arched windows underground, and that looks more like a doorway. That's an arched, big arch there. So, anyways, going back to what I was hinting at earlier, while I was doing this research, I learned a few things that I didn't know, and that, you know, sometimes you hit that one little spark of data that will set your mind going in a direction that takes you somewhere you didn't know you were going. And that's kind of what happened while I was looking over Sacramento here. And I'm not going to tell you what that is quite yet. I'll get to that a little bit later. Got a little drop in there. But it led me to start thinking about, I have always, since very early on in my research, believed that, I'm going to take a turn here, that the mud flood did not come from above. Some people believe that the mud flood was a flood event, like a rain flood, like Noah's Ark event. And I don't believe that's true. I believe that there was a great flood a long time ago in a much previous reset. I believe that that is, you know, something that we have, what, over 1,200 flood myths around the world. So, you know, I think that that can be proved out in that way. But I do not believe this is the flood, a mud flood event, where it came from above, to where the mud dropped down on top of the roofs. And the reason I don't believe that is because, for several reasons. Number one is that if you did drop mud from above, it would be too heavy on the roofs. And the roofs are not designed to carry the weight. This is a very interesting stair step. Look how steep that is. I'll get a little closer to that later on. I just wanted to make a note of that because you can't see that area from close up. But if you put all that weight onto the roofs of these buildings, they're not designed to hold that weight. And you can see here that there was, you see these right here, this is where floor joists were put into the brick here. So there was a floor right here, and there was obviously a building in this area. So they've removed the building right here. This may or may not be old right here. I don't know. It's hard to tell. But this definitely had another building right here, no doubt. Now, how big that building was, I don't know. We got, you know, obviously windows and doors below ground. But, you know, if you look at, let's say, a building on fire, the firemen go up there, and you could tell that the roofs, it doesn't take much before they start, you know, weakening, and the firefighters fall through roofs. Okay, you know, these roofs aren't designed to handle, well, no roof is really designed to handle, you know, that heat, but most definitely these old structures with the wood, the timbered roofs, they're not going to stand up to, you know, tons amount of water. And then if the water did get in, and the mud, you remember the mud is dirt, it's heavy. And so the dirt would be too load bearing, and it would just, you know, crush the floor, and then it would crush the next floor, and then you'd have an actual, you know, event where it collapsed a building due to pancaking. But it wouldn't come down in 9 seconds, it would come down probably a lot slower, but it would, you know, one floor would collapse another because you'd have dirt on top of dirt on top of dirt, floor on top of floor, and it would be too much. So I just don't believe, number one, that the mud came in from above. I just don't, that's my personal belief, personal opinion, that's not how it happened. That's nice right there. But, and I also, because of the flow of the mud, you see how this is flowing here. You can see this in every city. Okay. Now this is Sacramento. Old Sacramento is not a good example of mud flow, but in every city, well, not every city, some of them, like, let's say Chicago has been raised, where they, you know, raised it probably via viaducts, or Seattle, where they raised it. But in a lot of most cities, they didn't raise the ground level. It was actually, they're still sitting on the mud flow. So you can trace the mud flow, and the mud flow always goes downhill. Okay, there's you can find it. Just follow the mud, and if you trace the mud up, you're gonna find the top of the mud flow. Now, another theory is that these are supposed to be columns that were on an original building. This is supposed to be the ground level here. So, you know, another theory is that the mud came in from the side, like a flood of mud that came in, like a imagine a flood, let's say a river overflowing its banks. And I don't believe that that's how it happened either, because if so, you would have to have, basically they're saying that that theory goes, it comes from where the entire earth is flooded. And I don't believe that the entire earth was flooded. I've lost where I am. So I don't believe that is a good theory. Okay, I see where we're at. So I don't believe it flooded the entire area. So then it got me thinking, okay, well, if I believe that you can trace the mud flood, the mud flow, okay, and it goes downhill, then, you know, obviously it came from a point of origin. So then I'm looking, you know, well, how does that actually take place? What do you actually need in order, let's break it down, okay? So I'm breaking this down in my mind, and I'm looking around Old Sacramento. And I'm thinking, well, how did the, you know, mud flow into the town, but not across? It's targeted, is my point. Okay, I've always believed that the mud was targeted. So it's like, how do you target the mud flow? Where the hell do you get this mud from? And how do you target that mud to take out a town or a city? How do you do that? You know, that's been the question. I get asked this question all the time, and I think about this question, and I've not had a very good answer, other than I believe that it came in from the side, and I'll show some video here at some point of how I believe it looked as it was coming in. I believe it looked a lot like the Indonesia event where the oh, they're gonna let me get down here. Cool. Where the Indonesia liquefaction event. I believe it looked like that. Now, I do not believe that it was a liquefaction. That's another theory, is that the mud came in from liquefaction. I do not believe that it was liquefaction, and the reason I do not believe it was liquefaction is because the buildings are level, and you can't have level buildings and liquefaction. The two don't mix. You know, it's water and oil. They don't mix. Okay? So I don't believe it came from above. I don't believe it came from the sides in a mass flood. I do not believe it came from below. Okay, so but I do believe it came in targeted from the area that is attacked. So it's like, well, how the hell do you get this mud to, let's say, Old Sacramento or wherever? Name a city, name a town, okay? Anywhere in the world. Okay, that's another thing, is how do you get that I'm gonna go up and I'm gonna show you the Railroad Museum because they don't allow you to look at. This is a roundhouse right here, and what this allowed them to do is turn the trains around, and they would take them in here and work on them. And one thing I learned is that I didn't know this before until recently, is that you can't that the engines had to, the old steam engines, that they had to be serviced it for every day they worked. They had to be serviced for a day. So I thought that was very interesting. So I'm thinking, okay, well, how do you get, I'm getting to the point. Okay, I'm gonna have to make a shorter video on this theory, but I'm letting you see, you know, inside my inside thinking on and how I got there. So I started thinking about how do you accomplish this? Okay, say you're the bad guy. Okay, you're the asshole that's gonna cause the mud flood. Okay, well, how do you do that? Okay, I'm gonna be, you know, I'm gonna be the ruler of the world. I'm gonna take over the world. How do I do that with mud? Okay, I'm starting, and I'm really deeply thinking about this, meditating on this thought, and I'm looking around Old Sacramento, and I started thinking, well, what do you need to make mud? And there's what, have you ever thought about that? What do you need to make mud? Think about that question. What elements do you, and I'm not talking about how, like with what, I'm talking about like what elements do you need to make mud? Just simple mud. Not any particular kind of mud, just mud. If I told you to go outside and I need you to make me some mud in 5 minutes, or your life depends on it, okay? Make me some mud, okay? I want to go look around somewhere else for just for shits and giggles. Okay, I need you to make me some mud. Your life depends on it, okay? Where can I go? You know. So you go in, let's go look at St. Louis. I ain't been to St. Louis in a while. You know, how do you go outside and you make mud? And I know that sounds like a stupid question, but I really want you to think about that. I want you to really critically think about how do you make mud. It's really simple is the answer, okay? It's very think like a child, okay? And I'm toying with you a bit here because I want you to think, okay? I want you to think it through. I want you to figure it out for yourself. What is the elements that would be used to make mud? How would you do that? Okay? Go outside in your mind, in your child's mind. That's pretty. And I want you to make mud. Okay, what do you need? Okay, I'm going to give you a bucket. Okay, all right, I give you the bucket. I want you to put the mud in the bucket. Okay, just to give you a container. You don't need the container to make mud, but I'm just saying, you know, take a bucket outside and make me some mud. Okay, as a child, Imagine you're a child and your mama or your daddy tells you to go outside and play in the mud. And you go outside and there is no mud. Okay? You got your mud boots on. Whoa, those are crazy looking. You got your mud boots on. You're ready to go out. You're ready to play in the mud. You get out there, there's no mud. So you're like, whoa, I got to make my mud. So how do you make your mud? Think about that. Whoa, look at that. Whoa, that's a good one. Purdy. Oh man, it gets even better. Holy shit. So how do you make this mud? Okay. And I know a lot of you are out there like, look, dumbass, you do it like this. Okay. Okay. Well, a lot of people listening right now are going, I don't know what, just tell me, please, quit torturing me. But it's so simple, you're going to kick yourself. Okay. A lot of you can't, a lot of you have trouble just figuring out the simple things. Okay. But if you figure it out yourself, it's better. Okay. I'll give you a hint. You need two elements. Two. That is a crazy building. Wow, I'm glad I dropped in here tonight. So you got your two elements. You got your bucket, you go outside, and you're gonna make your mud with two elements. What do you need? Okay, it's real simple. You're a kid, you're 3 years old, 4 years old, you're gonna go make mud because mommy told you it was okay. Okay, daddy said go make some mud. It's all good. Go make the mud. Okay, you're out there, you got your bucket, you got your mud boots on, you're gonna make your mud. I know I'm being annoying. Oh my God, look at it. Holy shit, that's badass. Incredible. Look at that. Freaking badass, man. Green man dragons. That's off the freaking hook right there. Believe that's all wrought iron work right there. That is beautiful. That's just incredible. Okay, I'm gonna give you the first element. Okay, the first element you need is water. Okay, real simple. Water. Have you figured out the second element yet? Don't be super specific. Just think it through. What is the next simple ass element that you need in order to make dirt? There's old wind catchers right there, portholes for the wind catcher. What is the next element? It's real simple. Oh wow, I can punch in. Check that out. Okay, I think I've tortured you enough. The second element is dirt. Okay, dirt. Not any particular kind of dirt. Okay, there's lots of different kinds of dirt all around the world. So depending on where you are in the world, it depends on the kind of dirt that you're gonna have. So a guy in Australia is gonna make, got Tartarian lines there, is gonna make a dirt out of one type of soil, and a guy in America is gonna make dirt out of another kind of soil, and a guy in China is gonna make dirt out of a different kind of soil. Everybody's gonna make different dirt. Look at all those Tartarian lines. That's beautiful. So they're making, look at the scrubbed cartouches all the way up. So, you got your dirt, you got your water. Okay, you go outside, you make your mud. Okay. Now, let's up the game a little bit. I'm the bad guy, okay? I'm the guy's taking over the world, and I've decided I'm gonna attack every city, every town around the world with mud. Okay, that's gonna be my weapon of choice. I'm gonna bury it all in mud. Okay, then I'm gonna take it back over, and I'm gonna claim I found them, and I'm gonna write a date on them. Got flat earth asterisks. Gaslight company. Oh wow, how cool is that? Gaslight company. Check that shit out. So, I'm going to take over the world. Now, what is the next thing that I need? Okay, I know what I want to do. I want to bury, say, St. Louis in mud. Okay, that's what I want to do. I'm the evil mastermind here. I'm going to bury St. Louis in mud. Okay, and I'm going to do it, with dirt and water. Now, let me give you a little tip. Okay, every city, every town around the world, without fail, okay, now maybe they don't have it now, so don't go there. But at one point, when look at that, that is circuit boardy right there. At some point, okay, in the past, when they found this town, okay, when they built this town or city, check it out. Okay, what the hell, that man, that's a freaking language. What the hell's going on there? Okay, when they built these cities and towns, they had water, okay? Without question, you do not build a community in a location with no water. And I mean close, okay? You're gonna have water because without water, you die, okay? Simple as that. You can go without food for 40 days, okay? But you can't go without water, okay? It ain't happening. Forget about it. Okay? You gotta have water. Got a drop in right there. Probably a subway, maybe. Yeah. I can't remember. Does St. Louis have subway? I guess so. Yeah, subway. So every city, every town has around the world has water. Okay, so there's no need as the bad guy. Okay, I'm the bad guy. Okay, I'm gonna go to St. Louis and I'm going to attack it with my mud. I don't need to bring water. Okay, don't need to because they're gonna have water. Okay, there's no question they're gonna have water. You're not gonna build St. Louis or any other town or city without water. It's not gonna happen. You wouldn't do it because you'd die. Okay? You'd die. I mean, it's not like you're one dude, okay? You're not one, fella that's going out and oh, I can just, dig me up some little bit of groundwater, and no. You got to have water, okay? You got to have abundant water. You got to have a lake. You got to have a river. You got to have stream. You got to have underground aquifers. You got to have some form of water. Okay, this is just you're gonna have water. So you, as the evil genius, okay, I'm the evil genius gonna go attack St. Louis. I ain't gonna worry about bringing my water for my, mud flood attack. It's already gonna be provided. Okay. What about my second element? Do I need to bring the mud? Not the mud. Excuse me, the dirt. Check out the mud flood wonders there. Do I need to bring the dirt? No, I don't need to bring the dirt. There's already dirt. Check that out. There's already dirt. Okay? Everywhere around the world, there's dirt. Okay? Without fail. I don't care where you're at, unless you're in, the ocean. Okay? And even then, there's dirt underneath the ground. We call it sand, but it's still, a dirt of some sort. But excluding that, let's just take that out. The point is, if you're on land, you got dirt. Okay, so there's no need to bring the water or the dirt for my evil mastermind genius plan, because it's already gonna have water. Okay, and this is St. Louis, and obviously we have water right here. Okay, let's just pick another city to go play around with while I run my mouth for no particular reason. I don't know. Let me see. Where do I want to go? I don't know where I want to go. Oh, Vicksburg. I had a nice little stay in Vicksburg one time. Let's see. This is an old town. Very hilly. Major mud flow here. So, as the evil mastermind genius, I don't need to bring mud, thank God, or dirt, thank God, because dirt is heavy, and I don't need to bring water because water's heavy, and it takes up, well, a shitload of space. And if I'm gonna mud flood a town or city, I'm gonna need massive amounts, massive quantities. Oh, what we got there? Massive quantities of dirt and water. Okay, it's just gonna look, check out the underground there. I mean, come on. It's gonna take massive amounts of dirt and water to create my mud. Okay, so let's think about this. Check out the mud flow there. See, this is what I'm talking about. They did not raise the level here, so this is mud flow. Okay, so these buildings, if you get down in the basement of them, let's see, right here we got a level. This is the ground level here, okay, that they're modern day ground level, quote unquote. And that means there's one level, two levels. So if you go in this building, you go down two levels, you're gonna have at least two levels under the mud. Okay? It's still there. That building goes in there, I guarantee that there's it's you're gonna have two sub basements, it's gonna be there. You're gonna find, structure under there. And I bet you a nickel, if you get into these things, the higher you go, the deeper they go. So that's something to look into. Got torus fields here. So the next thing that I need as the evil mastermind of the mud flood takeover, I'm going to need what? Okay, I don't need to bring the mud, the dirt, and I don't need to bring the water. Okay, that's going to be provided, but I'm going to have to turn the water and the dirt into mud. Okay, think about that. How do I do that? Okay, how do I do that? I'm gonna let you stew on that one a bit. I'm gonna move on to another part of this theory. When I was looking around in Sacramento, I heard something. I don't know. Sometimes you hear things and it doesn't register. And that's probably what happened here. But this time it did register. And one thing they said about Sacramento is that when they ran the first transcontinental rail, old cannon, it's not a cannon, when they first ran the transcontinental railroad, that it ended in Sacramento. That was the end of the line. And I was like, huh. Well, that's very interesting because, that's a mudflood city. Okay, we know that city was mudflooded. I mean, it's definite, 100%. So I started thinking, if that's the end of the line, then, how. Where did that mud come from? I'm thinking about this old way of thinking about it. I'm thinking, if it came in from the side, like a moving liquefaction event, even though it didn't come up from the bottom, where did this mud come from? And long story short, that led me to think that, well, in every area of the country today, we have access to railroads. That became a very big thing. And I'll probably insert here a little video about how the railroads covered America.
The railroad played a major role in the growth of the nation. It unified a sprawling country and spurred the Industrial Revolution. Early railroads used horse-drawn carriages, but the real beginning of the railroad era began on Christmas Day, 1830, when the first steam locomotive inaugurated passenger service in Charleston. Within a decade, more than 2,800 miles of track were in operation, with 5 out of 6 New England states laying rails. By 1850, more than 9,000 miles of track had been laid as transportation links developed in the Northeast and Mid-Atlantic states and connected the growing Midwest. But it was during the decade between 1850 and 1860 that the railroads grew into a true network, serving all the states east of the Mississippi. Track mileage more than tripled. Construction was so great that the U.S. nearly equaled the rest of the world in total mileage. Rival transportation felt this growth in the West. Traffic shifted from the north-south axis of the rivers to the east-west axis of the rails. The railroads played a key role in the Civil War. Both sides moved troops and supplies in great number, but the superior network of the North contributed to the defeat of the Confederacy. The period after the Civil War until World War I was the golden age of railroads, with no other form of transportation to challenge its leadership. On May 10, 1869, the country was connected from coast to coast with the completion of the first transcontinental railroad at Promontory Point, Utah. Railroad construction had regional impact, too. Over a 20-year period, ranchers followed cattle routes like the famous Chisholm Trail north to shipping points in Missouri and Kansas until the railroads were extended into the Texas Range Country. During the decades after the Civil War, track was standardized, time zones were introduced, and by 1885, four new transcontinental lines had reached the West Coast. Railroads and the economy flourished, with cheap freight rates promoting industrialization and national markets. By 1930, railroads had reached their peak, with almost 430,000 miles of track. But competition from trucks and airlines eroded their business so that by the mid-70s, 10 railroads in the Northeast and Midwest were in bankruptcy. In 1971, Amtrak was formed by the government to provide passenger service that the railroad companies could not afford and serve as a link between major urban centers. The miles of railroad track have declined steadily since 1930, and the number of passengers traveling by train is now a fraction of what it once was, but railroads are still an important part of our transportation network.
There's a purpose to this railroad business, and let me go in here and look at some things in Utah. Ogden, I've been looking into Ogden recently. A very interesting little area here. This is the center of the Ogden here. This is all mud flooded, just so you know. Every bit of this is underground. There's windows and doors still underground here. Video to follow. We've got some mud flood boots on the ground getting out there and checking this place out now. But you know, in the mud flood research, you'll come to realize that the railroads were already here. That you know, the I don't believe the Chinese laborers, I don't believe that they built the railroads. I believe that they are actually, my personal opinion is that they uncovered the buildings and changed what needed to be changed in order that we could live in the places. And so, that being said, if you go with the assumption that the railroads were already here, you know, that kind of gets you thinking. And then you add in the underground railroads, whereas like Harriet Tubman, who may or may not have existed, she probably didn't, but if you add in Harriet Tubman, you know, and the Underground Railroads, and you got the new series on Amazon Prime where that's the premise of the story, is that instead of the Underground Railroad being just, you know, an underground network of you know, people helping slaves, check that out, underground, helping slaves escape, that they were using actual underground railroads, you know. And now I haven't seen them explain where those railroads, how they got there. Check that out, underground. But if you know, you got railroads all across the country, Okay. And then you got this is a cool little city. Then you got you've also got railroads. If you look into it even deeper, you've got railroads all around the world. Okay. Now, correct me if I'm wrong. I could be. I don't know for 100%, but I believe that there are railroads all around the world. On every, Australia and Africa and Russia and America and South America and I mean all around the world, railroads, okay? Now I could be wrong about that. There could be a few places that don't have railroads that I haven't discovered. And I'm not saying every town and city has a railroad. What I think, though, could probably be proved out with quite a bit of research. And I'm not saying that this theory is 100% the truth. I don't believe that there is a 100% truth. Okay, I think anybody that's telling you that they have the truth is lying to you. Okay, they're flat out lying. Not that they're just mistaken, that they're lying. Okay, so if they say this is the truth, then they're full of shit. And that's how you know they're full of shit. They say, I'm the truth. I have the truth. This is the truth. Okay, they're full of shit. Okay, that's just period. Okay, there is no 100% truth. It doesn't exist. What's true for me is not going to be true for you. Okay? Because you don't have the knowledge that I have. Okay? And I don't have the knowledge that you have. Okay? So my truth and your truth and other people's truth are going to be completely different. And that's just the way it is, man. And how the hell do you know that you've gotten to the truth? You know? Has God come down and tapped you on the shoulder and said, son, you're the truth? No. No, that hasn't occurred. Okay? So what I'm saying here is, check out this underground winders right there, arch winders. Nice. What I'm saying is that this is a theory, okay? This is a new theory. And the first part of the theory is that mud is comprised of two elements, water and mud, and that water and mud is located around the world in every location that has been mud flooded. Okay? Simple. The second part of the theory is that this mud would need to be made in some way. Okay? The third part of the theory has to do with the railroads. Okay? The railroads. I believe the railroads were here. I believe the railroads were used in the mud flood. Okay? I believe they were part of it. Now, that being said, if I'm the evil mastermind, okay, and I'm going to attack this little city right here, okay, and I'm gonna mud flood it, okay, and I know that I'm gonna roll, I'm gonna come to this area, and that is incredible right there. What is this thing? Look at that clock. Jeez. So I'm gonna roll up on this area. Okay, now how am I gonna get this accomplished? Okay. Well, I need something to create this mud. Okay. And what would we call that? What would you call what the thing, okay, that in simple terms, not just think like a child, okay? I'm gonna say, what are you gonna use to attack this city and create mud? To what would you call it? You know, I don't know how I don't know how to toy around with your mind here enough to confuse you or make you understand or make you figure it out. I'm just trying to give you a chance to figure this out for yourself. Oh, baby, look at that. Purdy. Oh, you don't. Oh, man. Damn. That's crazy. So, look. I'm gonna attack this city with my mud flood. What? What would it be called? I want you to figure it out yourself, Circumpunk, symbol for the creator. What would you call it? Okay. All right. For all you simple-minded folks out there that ain't figured out what I'm saying, a weapon. Simple. Okay? So your three elements so far are water, dirt, and a weapon. Okay? Even Mastermind has got water, dirt, and a weapon when he comes to your city or your town to mudflood you. Okay? That's what the evil Mastermind's got. Okay? Real simple. Trapdoor going to the underground right there. Not melted box. Use your head, people. Underground right there. So you got a weapon, you got your dirt, and you got your water. Now, how do you get as the evil mastermind? Okay, yeah, we're not talking. I don't think. I really don't. Now, I could be wrong, but this is my theory, and I'm going to board out. Now, I need to get around, and I need to transfer my weapon around the world to every city and town that I'm going to mud flood. How do I get that weapon to these places? I believe that was the railroads. I believe the railroads were here, and I believe they loaded the weapon onto the trains. I do not have a determination as to if they left the weapon, or if they used the, they came in, they used the weapon and left and went and did another town, city. I think that more than likely that there were enough trains to do that either every town and city that needed to be done underground there. Or that I've even had the thought that maybe they did the towns quickly, like came in and did the towns and then went and did the cities because they would take longer, and maybe they left the weapons in the city on the trains and they got buried in the mud with the buildings. That could be bored out later. That's something to think about. I think it's more important to think about how it was actually done. So I think that they rolled up into each town and city, and they used this weapon on these locations, and that more than probably, in my thinking, I could be wrong here. I mean, you know, this is just a theory. That they had enough weapons to do every major city. They had enough train, you know, engines to do every city and leave the weapon in the major city. Maybe even enough to do most large towns, but maybe the individual smaller towns were done very quickly and they moved on and just they came rolled into a small town and they that looks Egyptian. The dead shall be raised. What the? Got a winged disc? What the hell? Kind of crazy shit's this? I don't know. So, that is, what the hell, man? That's really creepy. Dead shall be raised. Okay, that's super creepy. What the hell, man? Is that a mausoleum? I don't know what the hell's going on here. So, I guess that leads in. I know I'm drawing this out. I'm letting you think this through as I'm going through it. Okay, I'm purposely drawing this out. I want you to think, how this could be done and see what you come up with and see if what you come up with matches what I come up with and what collectively when I discuss this with both Calum and Ozbeast, what they came up with. But we I, it hit me at some point as I was thinking, what kind of weapon has the capability to create mud with water and dirt, is can be mobile, that's small enough to be that's movable. We're not talking like some massive freaking, super weapon here that's like a huge thing. It's got to be, that's a beautiful building. It's got to be small enough that it's mobile. It's also got, it can't be so elaborate that you can't have enough of them to handle all the cities and towns that need to be attacked, not to mention around the world. Okay? So it has to be a relatively simple weapon, something that can be, mass produced quickly, easily, something that can be that is mobile enough to move around the world quickly, efficiently, something that works very well, something that, I mean, what kind of weapon will do that? A gun? You think about how does let's say back during the Olympics in China when they said, okay, we're gonna make sure that there's no rain, and they shot stuff into the clouds to chemicals in the clouds and made it so it wouldn't rain. They weather modified so it would not rain. Okay, and we all know they weather got some obelisk here. Little mini obelisk. Does that not that looks all kinds of too short. But we know they weather modify, okay? We know this. Everybody knows this. If you're awakened and you're searching for answers, you've already learned this. This is nothing new. That our weather is not real anymore. Mother Nature, she's, who knows? She fucked off somewhere. That we know that they control the weather. Yep. It's look like portholes there. I don't know. This might be an old, a new building. I don't know. I don't know. It's hard to tell. Couldn't tell you. So we know that they modify the weather. We know that. Okay, that's old hat, whatever. Okay, this is nothing we don't know. So we got that underground right there. So I got more underground there. So then it got me thinking about what kind of device could be used to do this. And you know, it just hit me like a ton of bricks. And it was just like, that's it. It was so clear when it hit me, like, well, that's a good idea. That's very possibly how it was done. And so here's what I came up with. Have you ever heard of Wilhelm Reich? Have you ever heard of a cloud buster? That is a beautiful, beautiful structure right there. Both of those are. A cloud buster was designed by a gentleman named Wilhelm Reich, and he studied what he called orgone energy, positive and negative, and changing positive energy into negative energy. And he created what he called organite, and he also created an orgone accumulator, which was a box that when it's underground there. Those are just picture perfect right there. Oh my God. So he created this orgone accumulator, and this orgone accumulator you could get in, and it would supposedly cure cancer. And he also created what was called a cloud buster. A cloud buster is a machine, a very simple machine that can either make it rain or make it stop raining. And Wilhelm Reich would, people would pay him to come and make it rain at their location, to save their crops, in droughts, or if they were getting too much rain, he could make it stop raining. And then they arrested him and they threw him in jail and he died. And then they came and they stole his research and they burned his books. And he went the way of Nikola Tesla. I can't say, you know, for sure is this true? You know, is Wilhelm Reich, did he do everything that's attributed to him? You know, I can't say that for sure. My that structure right there is just phenomenal. Whatever is going on right there, that's crazy. I can't say 100% sure that he is, you know, his story is legit. Just like Nikola Tesla, I mean, you know, we originally thought that Nikola Tesla was, you know, the super genius man that was you know, came up with all these things, and then, you know, come to find out later on that more than likely he didn't do diddly squat, and he just, you know, was accredited for found technologies, blah blah blah. Okay, so, you know, is Wilhelm Reich like Nikola Tesla? I don't know. Is it possible? Yes. Is he possibly legitimate? Yes. You know, which is it? I don't know. Unimportant. Okay, but what we do have is what's called the cloud buster. So I was thinking basically that what could be done is that they could have had a cloud buster mounted on a train, and they pull up to a location, and they aimed it at a hill or a mountain, and they blasted this orgone energy, this cloud buster technology. It probably wouldn't have been called a cloud buster, but and they aimed it and created mud. And as I'm explaining this to Calum, look at the Tartarian lines. Phoenician shells. As I'm explaining it to him, he makes this comment, and at first when he said it, I was like, wait, what? Like, I didn't understand what he was saying, and because it sounded like he was disagreeing with the theory, and I thought, oh, okay, where am I wrong? You know, what? And he said, no, you're not wrong. You're right. And I'm like, well, wait a minute. And what he said was, he made the comment, all you need is rain. And I thought what he was saying was that, that it was done with rain. I'm like, oh crap. Caleb, we're back to square one. You know, I was thinking that he's one of these fellas that's in the thinking that the rain, look at that mud action right there. He's one of these fellas that's thinking that the mud was rained in, you know, or some their derivative of. I was like, crap, you know, this conversation is not going anywhere. And I was thinking to myself, my dadgummit, you know, I'm hoping to get some feedback here, and I really felt like I was on to something here. So I was a little frustrated, and he's like, no, you're not. He's basically like, dumbass, listen to me, you're not hearing me. And then I got what he was saying. He wasn't saying that it was done with rain the old school way. He was saying that I was right, that the cloud buster could be used to make it rain. And what I understood at that point was that they would, the theory being that they would bring in, they would roll in on a train to, let's say, Kansas City, which is where I'm at right now, and they would point the cloud buster over, say, a hill or a mountain, and they would make it rain over this hill or mountain, and the mud would then flow. I mean, they would really make it rain, like big time, okay? And they would just drench this thing, and the mud would just start sliding down the hill. And they would basically sluice with rain a mountain or a hill. And they would do it so much that it would literally create a mud flow that would then run downhill into the city. And it would flood out, mud flow the city to the point that we see what we see today that we call the mud flood. That the mud was created on the spot. They would, the water would be drawn up from, you know, drawn in from the atmosphere, and you know that with the water, you know, there's always water in the area because, you know, you have to have water in the area. So that flat earth asterisk portholes, you'd have to have the water in the area. Okay, so there would be water in the atmosphere. More flat earth asterisks there. So, you know, they would roll in, and they would set this cloud buster off, and it would triangulate over a hill or a mountain, and they would flood out a city or a town. And then roll on to the next city or town, or say in a case where, example being, let's say San Francisco, where it's really large, maybe they just left the machine, there. And I'm going to show you some videos here on the end of this of, in case you're unaware of Wilhelm Reich and the Cloud Buster, I'm going to show you a video of, got griffins here, of, Tartarian griffins. I'm going to show you a video of Wilhelm Reich's work with the Cloudbusters. And also there is a video, a music video I found, where the I can't remember, I think the song's called Cloudbusters. I think it's by Kate Bush. Hope I said that right. But she sung a song and she has a music video called Cloudbuster or Cloudbusters or something like that, and that's what she's talking about. Now, and so she's trying to, tell the people, about these Cloudbusters. And another thing I think is interesting, is in the video, and you know how they like to tell us things in the video? Check out that underground right there. Let's go back and look at this one. You know how they like to tell us things in the movies and the TVs and the videos and stuff? Well, in this video, she uses that she has she's sitting on and playing with this Cloudbuster, right? But I'm sitting there thinking, you're gonna see video and pictures of Wilhelm Reich's Cloudbuster, his actual Cloudbuster, okay? You're gonna see images of it. But what is interesting to me is that in Kate Bush's video that she shows a Cloudbuster that I was dumbfounded when I saw it. It doesn't look like Wilhelm Reich's Cloudbuster. It looks just like the sound weapons from World War II. And so I'm going to show you some pictures of that as well. And you're going to see that what if we all know that, not World War II, excuse me, World War I, the sound weapons from World War I. So, we know that World War I was a bunch of horse shit. And we, those sound weapons are very strange. Well, what if those sound weapons were not sound weapons? What if, just what if, I'm, spitballing here, okay? This is all spitballing, okay? We don't know for sure. It's just, let's think this through. What if those sound weapons were the Cloudbuster weapons? What if they just repurposed the Cloudbusters and used them in World War One, or took pictures of them and called them sound weapons? What if the Cloudbusters back in the day were called sound weapons? I don't know. I'm just, spitballing here. Let's, think outside the box, because we're not going to get there the same way that we, got here. We're not going to get to the answers in the same way. We've got to think a different way.
He continued to develop new ways to visualize, measure, and harness orgone energy from the atmosphere. The Cloudbuster, for example, was an experimental instrument that could affect weather patterns by altering concentrations of orgone energy in the atmosphere. A set of hollow metal pipes and cables inserted into water creates a stronger orgone energy system than that in the surrounding atmosphere. Water, which strongly attracts and absorbs orgone, draws the atmospheric energy through the pipes. This movement of orgone from a lower to a higher energy system was used by Reich to create clouds and to dissipate them. In 1953, during a long drought that threatened the main blueberry crop, several farmers offered to pay Reich if he could bring rain to the parched region. The Weather Bureau had forecast no rain for several days when Reich began his cloud-busting operations. 10 hours later, a light rain began to fall. Over the next few days, close to 2 inches fell. The blueberry crop was saved.
I was a farmer back in 53, and our crops had suffered the worst drought in 40 years. And then we heard of a man called Wilhelm Reich, who claimed he could make rain using a machine he called the Cloudbuster. So, we wrote him a letter, asking for his help. The offer was simple, money for rain. Reich arrived with his son, Peter. He promised his rain within 24 hours. I remember asking him how it worked. He said kind of like a lightning rod, using an energy he called argon. I only found out later why the men from the government were watching him. If anything, I remember the air getting drier, but I didn't doubt him. Reich had a confidence that stuck to you. Everybody simply waited, passing time, hoping the strange machine would work. machine sure did something. And that was the last I ever saw of Wilhelm Reich.
So, I guess that's pretty much the new theory, in a nutshell. Is it perfect? Probably not. Is it proven? Hell no. Is it something that I think can be thought out more? Damn right. I would love to hear others' opinions and see what you think. See if you... you know, find validity in it. See if you find, you know, a hole in it. You know, is there a town or a city anywhere in the world, okay, that you know of that you feel is mud flooded, okay, that does not have water, does not have dirt, and does not have railroad? And I'm not talking about now, because you'll learn researching railroads that they have destroyed a lot of the railroad. So at some point, did it have railroad? Is there a history of railroad in that location? You know, it, you have to go deep into the railroads. They're not going to give it to you. Okay, it's not simple. So is there any is there a history of some sort of railroad? And it doesn't have to be exactly in your location. It doesn't have to be, or not your location, but it doesn't exactly have to be in the city or town. It doesn't have to roll up to it and be exactly beside it, because we're talking about triangulation here. We're talking about you're sitting on a railroad track, and you could be 50 miles, 100 miles away. I don't see why that wouldn't be possible. Is that what happened? I don't know. It's just thinking outside the box here. But through triangulation, you know, you shoot up above a hill and aim it in the proper, you know, way and make it rain over this mountain or hill. And then the mud comes in. I mean, you know, so what I'm saying is, leave in the comment section if you know of a city that doesn't have water, dirt, and access to railroad within, you know, let's be reasonable. Let's say, you know, 50 miles. I mean, I don't know. I mean, it could be a hell of a lot further, but I mean, let's be reasonable. You know, is there a place that is like that? And I realize that the histories say, oh, they didn't build the railroads till later. I know that. Well, that's bullshit, okay? The railroads are here, okay? So you've got to let that go first off. Just to go with this theory, okay, you have to understand that the railroads were already here. That's first fact. You just have to accept that. I mean, it's, and I'm not telling you that's the truth, okay? You just have to figure that out on your own, okay? You have to come to that conclusion on your own. I can't make you understand that. That's something you're going to have to figure out. But in my opinion, okay, that the railroads were here, and that they were all over the world. And so if you take that into consideration, then you've got your railroads, because I believe they're everywhere. If you look at railroad maps, they're just freaking everywhere. And then if you look at the cloud busters, I mean, Wilhelm Reich's version, I mean, it's very simple, very, very simple. So, you know, there's that. I don't believe, that's one, another thing that's interesting about his cloud buster, that you'll learn, and they'll talk about this in a little video I'm going to show you. I'm gonna try to show you. I think that it's gonna, YouTube will let me show it to you. So the Wilhelm Reich's Cloudbuster, he didn't need to put water into the machine, but to increase its efficiency like a lot, he could drop hoses into the water, into like a lake, and it would increase the efficiency dramatically. Got a flat earth asterisk right there on that door, you know. So I think that's very interesting, because what if they could have pulled up on the trains and hooked into the local water supply, a lake or a river or an aquifer, and used the local, check that out, the local water supply to against the people. It used their own water, you know, and he maybe they used that to increase the machine's power. So that's something to think about. So the theory, I'm trying to be as clear as I can with this. I know this has been long and drawn out and painful. Sorry for that. The reason I drew it out is because I wanted you to think and try to work it out for yourself. It's a lot easier if I do this one-on-one, because I can basically torture you indefinitely, which is what I did to Caleb and Oz Beast. It just absolutely drove them nuts for, you know, probably 30 minutes, probably an hour each, probably a good hour each, just making them guess each little bit. But they really appreciated it in the end, because they figured it out for themselves. And I personally think that is the best way to learn. But I don't have that luxury with you all, because I don't talk to you one-on-one, so that just wasn't a possibility. So I had to do it this way, and I did the best I could with what I got. And now, once I've gone through this long, drawn-out version, I can, you know, later come back and do a short version that's, you know, it's a lot easier and much less painful. But the theory in a nutshell is that you need water, dirt, which are on location. You need a way to you need a weapon, which I believe is the cloud buster, or a cloudbuster type weapon. Doesn't have to actually be the cloudbuster, but a cloudbuster type weapon, a weapon that creates triangulated rain, where you can aim it above an area and pinpoint accurately hit a target. And then I believe you need a way to roll this weapon around, that you need it mobile, because mobility is key. I don't believe that it was brought in with airships, although it could have been. Let's not rule that out. My feeling right now, my gut is telling me that they used the railroads. So that's the theory. Water, dirt, cloudbuster, railroad. And I'm going to show some videos now, some, you know, stuff to think about. And I hope you guys enjoyed. Let me know what you think in the comments. Maybe you have some additional ideas here. This is not the truth. This is just a theory. It is not the absolute facts. And I don't have the absolute facts. I'm trying to get to the point where I have, you know, some better facts than I have now, because there's a lot of theories going around that are just absolute horseshit. And instead of letting absolute horseshit theories run, you know, the roads, you know, I need to, you know, figure out what I think. And, you know, I need to do better. Because, you know, there's a lot of stupid fucking people in the world. And I'm not one of them. So I need to prove it. Not to you. I need to prove it to myself. I need to use the mind that the Creator gave me. And I need to help everyone else find the answers as well. I'll show you one last thing. Let me get my bearings here. Oh, okay. Okay, look. Salt Lake City, okay? Example. I'm gonna pull up, okay, and go find the railroad. Okay, let's find the railroad. Okay, got the railroad here. Okay, there's the railroad. Boom. Okay, we got our railroad. Got water here, okay? It's probably more water. Yep, more water there, Provo. Okay, so we got railroad, we got water, and we got, well, where's the dirt? Boom. Okay, we got dirt. A lot of dirt, okay? We need it higher than the city, okay? We all know that Salt Lake City is a mudflood city. And if you don't know that, just go look at the temple, okay? Because the temple is is super duper flooded, okay? I believe it's up to, I can't remember the numbers, I think it's 30 to 40 feet flooded that we know of. So that's buried by 30 to 40 feet right there. Okay, we already know that. Okay, we believe the temple is the old world, that Brigham Young came in and plopped his ass down here and took over this area and came up with this horseshit narrative. Okay, so I believe that what they did was they rolled in on a train with the Cloudbuster, and then they triangulated, let me back up here a little bit, they triangulated over, let me get where you can really see this. They triangulated over this hill area, and I believe this was much higher at the time, okay? Or it was wider, or this whole area here. I think that the mud for Salt Lake City came in from right here. And they made it rain. They triangulated from the train, the Cloudbuster weapon, over this area here, made it rain, and then the mud flowed downhill. You see this nice little trench they got here? Okay, check that out. It rolled down, boom, and flooded that sucker out. That's my theory. Okay. And no, that's not a melted building. Use your head, people. I still dream of Organon. I wake up crying. You're making rain, and you're just in reach. When you in sleep escape me, you're like my yo-yo. That glowed in the dark, what made it special, made it dangerous, so I bury it and forget. Just say it.
Captain O'Riddle, it's not an enigma! Don't you get it?
Say woof again! Say woof again!
I've got one that can see.
Welcome to the underground.
This is my kung fu, and it is strong.
See you later!